नमस्कार आईच्या या ग्राउंड झिरोक तुमकां सगळ्यांक येवकार. आनी आज आमचे बरोबर अशे खास गॅस्ट आसात जांकां आनी ज्या विशयाचेर आमी उलयतले, म्हाका दिसता सगळ्या गोंयान आनीक भारतानय आयकुपाक जाय. आमचे बरोबर आसात अलाहाबाद हायकोर्टाचे आदले चीफ जस्टीस गोंयकार फेरदीन बाब रिबेलो. सर, वेलकम टू द शो. And the topic that we are discussing today is a very crucial one, and that is the Lokayukta amendments that were passed by the Legislative Assembly of Goa last week. So you have gone through the amendments. What are your initial comments? How do these amendments look to you?
Thank you for first inviting me. I normally don't come on TV channels.
Oh, pleasure, sir.
I think this is an issue that all of us should be concerned with, namely rooting out corruption, nepotism, and maladministration of government. The concept of justice is to provide to the people an efficient administration, a corrupt-free administration, a government free from nepotism and maladministration. Now, I may briefly describe this amendment. As I strongly feel about it, in legal language can be understood as a considerable exercise of power or a fraud on power. What that means is that though the assembly does have the power to enact this law, the amendment is not for a bona fide purpose. It is for a colorable exercise meant to protect the corrupt, meant to protect those who indulge in maladministration, and meant to protect those involved in nepotism. And more importantly, the worst part of the amendment is that even before the Lokayukta can commence an investigation, his hands are tied. He cannot go into the issue unless and until a competent authority gives permission. I will give an illustration. A is accused of corruption, which is an offense under the Prevention of Corruption Act.
Yeah.
Now, Prevention of Corruption Act requires permission of the competent authority before prosecution is launched. It does not require permission to investigate. It is only when a prima facie case of corruption, nepotism, or maladministration is found out, then can the sanction of the concerned competent authority is required. Now, under the Act as it stood, Section 17, this protection was already given to a public official. So it was only after investigation, if there was a prima facie case found out and before prosecution, the competent authority had to grant sanction. Now, what the new amendment has done is, even before this process can be started, even before investigation can be commenced on a complaint, the sanctioning authority under the CRPC has to grant permission. Now, this is unheard of.
Yeah.
That you cannot investigate a complaint against a person alleged of corruption without taking prior sanction of the competent authority. And who are the competent authorities? The competent authorities will be seniors to the very officials or the concerned ministers concerned. Now, do you expect any matter to go further? In other words, you have tied the hands of the Lokayukta even before he can open the file to look into the complaint. This is the sum total effect of this particular amendment.
So let's go clause by clause. One clause that changes the definition of corruption. And the definition of corruption amendment of Section 2, which says that nepotism or lack of integrity, these words shall be omitted, and B, or improper or corrupt motive shall be omitted. And then it is substituted with, as far as the benefit given to the closed ones or family members is concerned, it accurately actually specifies which are the relationships that fall in the ambit of corruption. When you look at this, what do you think is the motive behind this?
One say, but again to shield those involved in nepotism, corrupt activities. Now, what is nepotism? Nepotism means an act to favor either your near relatives or your favorites by giving them jobs or by giving them contracts or other favors. So what we are doing is, you are practically taking away and saying now you are free to indulge in nepotism. You're free to do whatever you want, except if it is restricted to close family members. Now, that was not the concept under the Act as it stood.
Yes.
The Act, it was any person. Hmm. So any person was broad enough to include your political appointees, your political cohorts, your political workers or anybody. See, the concept of what is public employment? Hmm. Public employment must be free, it must be fair, and it must be impartial based upon the merits of the candidate. Of course, subject to the reservation which the Constitution provides, but it must be based upon merit. Now, what you are doing is taking only a class of family members and keeping out the rest. Now, this is not the object of the look for which the Lok Ayukta was enacted. And this is not what is there in the Lokpal bill, definitely.
Yeah.
The Lokpal Act does not contain this thing, what the Goa Assembly has done. Hmm. Of course, the Lokpal Act has corruption, but the Goa Act, when enacted, had far more nepotism, maladministration, etc. So what is maladministration?
So another crucial issue that everybody is debating is about the dilution of the eligibility criteria from a retired Chief Justice of a High Court to a Supreme Court judge to saying that any justice of the High Court, and then a super dilution of the eligibility criteria for Upalokayukta. And the government has been consistently saying that it is difficult to find candidates. Do you buy this argument that it is difficult to get candidates if the criteria is retired Chief Justice of the High Court or Judge of the Supreme Court?
I will deal with the issue of Lok Ayukta and deal with the issue of Upalokayukta separately. Hmm. In so far as Lok Ayukta is concerned, possibly or probably, Goa being a small state, getting a chief. Retired judge of the Supreme Court or a chief justice may be difficult. Perhaps attempts have been made and the government may not have responded.
Okay.
To that extent, yes, I agree that a retired a judge of that particular amendment, bringing in a high court judge, but then there ought to have been some sort of cut-off line. A high court judge, say, with at least 10 years experience. But that cut-off line is not there. Now, therefore, in so far the first part is concerned, I can understand.
You are saying there is some logic, some reasoning behind it.
There is some logic, some reasoning behind that. I can't. But why they have deleted the Chief Justice, I don't know. Hmm. Tomorrow, some Chief Justice may, in the sense, if not for today, sometime here, some Chief Justice may agree. But why the Chief Justice has been deleted, I cannot understand. Otherwise, there is some logic in there.
Okay.
But in so far as the second part of Upalokayukta is concerned, that is totally baffling. And cannot be understood. Whom do you require in this investigation? A person who has experience, a judicial approach, not a policeman, but a person who will balance things out. Because imagine the way it is not as if every complaint may be meritorious. There may be cases in which people are using the forum of the Lok Ayukta to use it as a tool of oppression against somebody else. Mm. Therefore, the person who sits on that chair has to have a balanced approach. And this balanced approach comes by a long, long years of presiding over cases, understanding the manner and trying to do justice in the matter. Therefore, for me, diluting insofar the Lokayukta is concerned is totally baffling. I can understand if a high court judge is presiding, another high court judge may have, but at least the rank of a district judge with experience. But here they have used all kinds of persons. Now, what kind of experience will these persons bring into an investigation? At least I am not in a position to comprehend. Mm. So to me, the second part of the amendment of Lokayukta is totally, I will use the word, cannot be stomached. Mm. In human's parlance. Mm.
So another very contentious point in these amendments is regarding the deemed rejection and deemed acceptance. So initially, I remember in 2013 when Manohar Parrikar tried to bring this bill, the initial draft of this bill was deemed rejection. So three months later, if the government doesn't decide anything, the report is deemed rejected. And then there was a lot of uproar within the civil society. Many objected to this amendment, and finally Manohar Parrikar had conceded that the deemed rejection has to be deemed acceptance. So the idea was at least government will have to come forward and say we are rejecting this for these many reasons. Right now it has been reversed back to deemed rejection. How do you think this affects the overall authority of Lokayukta?
As I said, the Lokayukta starts with his hands already tied down. Hmm. After his hands are uncuffed, as I would use the expression, if he goes into a matter and the government or the concerned officer sits over the file, all that he has to do is not put up a noting on the file, keep it pending as it happens in most government offices today. Mm. So the effect would be you don't have to do anything. Mm. Just wait for the expiry of time. Mm. Normally in legislations, I have come across various laws which is say if it, within the particular period, if you do not do, it will deem to have been granted.
Yeah.
It never says it will deem to have been rejected.
Yeah.
So this is completely a topsy-turvy manner in which things have been done. The whole approach appears to be put the Lokayukta and its report into a dustbin.
Mm.
My question is, if you want to have who in his right mind would want to occupy the chair of a Lokayukta with all these his hands tied up?
Mm.
And if by chance a judge decides to accept it, all the work that he will put in can be put to a nullity only by somebody sitting down on the file, and then there goes the report. I think this is not what Anna Hazare went on a fast for. Mm. See, entire civil society of India supported Anna Hazare. Why? Because the idea was root out corruption, root out nepotism, root out maladministration from society, from a civil services, from the day-to-day function of the government. You take the fate of a common man who has got no, a citizen,
mm.
who has no influence.
Yeah.
In day-to-day work, his file will be delayed. Somebody will raise some objection. You, as an illustration, just take the case. I call this also a fishy amendment.
Mm.
If you recollect the case of that inspector in the FDA,
yeah,
that found out formalin in the fish.
Yeah.
See the amount of harassment that candidate, I don't know who the candidate is, and I've got, but look at it.
Yeah.
What happens?
Mm.
Look at what happened yesterday. The Supreme Court, the High Court, in the matter of recruitment in the electrical department.
Yes.
Suddenly at the last moment, for the dilution of qualifications at the stage of oral examination,
yeah.
oral interviews. Now, this again was done at the last moment. And what would be such an objective? I and you can reason it out.
Yeah.
That those who have not managed well in the written examination should be brought into the back door. Luckily, the High Court and the Supreme Court have struck down those appointments.
Yeah.
But just imagine if this is going to fade, or what citizens are going to suffer, then what is this objective in having a Lok Ayukta?
So you touched that subject briefly, but I want to ask you very clearly, because many people, even in the state assembly, that they said that after looking at these amendments and the stature at which the institution of Lokayukta has been reduced to, that no judge of High Court will be willing to take up this position in future, because this is not just a toothless tiger, this has become a paper tiger. Do you agree with that?
I see, ultimately, it is for the candidate who may accept it or may not accept it. But as far as my opinion is concerned, after seeing these amendments, the candidate or the person who occupies this office will be just occupying the chair. As I said, straight one, he will not be, because what remains is only acts of corruption.
Yeah.
Nepotism has gone on, maladministration has gone on, has gone off, and whom does the act deal with? The act only deals with government officials and ministers, and maybe some other in other governmental organizations. It does not deal with private organizations. So what we are dealing, you are starting, and when there was already a protection under Section 17 of the Act, if some injust, perhaps in a case where somebody has, a Lok Ayukta may have gone, it's not that every time a judgment is right. You see, that is why you have the hierarchy of courts.
Correct.
That a low court judgment will be looked into by a higher court. So it is possible that sometimes somewhere something may have been overlooked, but not in such cases of a judge who has an experience of sitting on a high court.
Yeah.
So basically, to me, I do not know whether with this kind of amendment any judge would accept it or not. I cannot speak. I can speak for myself.
You wouldn't accept it,
but this is definitely not something which anybody would accept. Should accept.
So very frankly, because again you said very rightly that although it is an assembly, although it is passed by a brute majority, it doesn't make it right. As a jurist, when you look at the trend across the country, when bills like this are getting passed in the House with brute majorities, does that worry you?
You see, at the end of the day, there are some democratic norms that have to be accepted. We can't really look into that issue. But there was a time when even members of the ruling party would put forward their opinions and express their views. It is not as if there was always a they put their thumb impression to whatever the government brought in. Ultimately, they may vote, but they would express on the floor of the House their reservations, and it would be considered. I remember on the floor of the House, I also happened to be MLA.
Yes, in the same assembly.
Post-emergency.
Yeah.
Post-emergency. It was accidental, but I went into it and I was there. And believe me, I wanted to bring an amendment to the Munkar Act because I found that there was a lacuna. I raised the issue. And you know what Mrs. Kakodkar said, the Chief Minister? He said, why don't you move the amendment? She could have always said, officially, we'll bring the amendment. But no. She said, you have raised the issue. There is a point in which you have raised. We will welcome the amendment. Please raise the amendment. This was the kind of assemblies that were there. Now, we don't expect everything, but at least I thought there would be people of the ruling party who would point out. They may not agree with the government, but who would also have expressed their views. And I only hope, I do not know what the future holds for us.
Sir, last question before I let you go. You spoke about all these things and somehow these norms, this magnanimous nature is somehow getting diluted. However, do you think as far as the Indian judiciary today is concerned, is doing a fair job of defending the values that we espouse for in a democracy?
It's a very difficult question to answer, but let me be frank. By and large, the judiciary was objective and meant and protecting the rule of law. But over the last several years, I would not name, and commencing with our chip, there has been a disturbing trend not only for me. See, I have served that institution for 15 years.
Yes.
I was a lawyer myself for about 22 years. So it is in the cause of justice. And there are people like me, both outside and inside, who are feeling disturbed as to what is happening. See, at end of the day, people have the last resort of the people is in the judiciary. It is the bastion. It is their faith in that.
Yeah.
And if the faith of the people in the judicial system erodes, then what is left of this democratic structure? We always say all three parts of the government must work in tandem. But there are problems on the other side. And it is the role of the judiciary to check acts of government and acts of the legislature as to whether they fall within the constitutional framework. And that is the job. And sometimes when we see preferences given to a particular kind of matters and matters of immense importance in the constitutional scheme of things, so a large section of people are not dealt with, you really feel sad. But I only hope that years ahead, that like, but I would only use the word that, of course, see, all of us come from the high courts. We are either, those who go to the Supreme Court are mostly, are 80% judges, 85% judges from the high courts. We have a long experience of 14, 15 years.
Yeah.
And then we have a few judges who come directly from the bar to the Supreme Court. But many of us feel that things ought to be better. That's all that I can say.
Sir, you are a Goenkar and we are all proud of you. So when we are ending this interview at this juncture of our democracy, because you have been a part of an electoral process also, and you have been at the heights of the judicial process also. So what is your message to Goenkars?
I will tell you before I say anything, I was a legislator, and believe me, I always said it to my colleagues in the court, that when I interpret a legislation, I can understand it much better than most of you who have only been lawyers. Apart from being a legislator, I was also active in social movements.
Yes.
So I can understand the pulse of the people and the feeling of the people. And that when an act is brought, what you must feel is the objective of the act. What more to our civil society? The civil society is becoming active in Goa today. I hope that happens, and I hope that the civil society does not cross into politicians. See, because you require strong NGOs.
You require those pressure groups.
Civil society members to work outside political parties. It is not as if it is only political parties. Of course, political parties are a part of a democratic process. They are the ones who have to run governments. But then it is not, everything that is done by them is never always right.
Yeah.
See, it's like a youngster who revolts. It is a young who revolts. Old yeah. man don't revolt.
Yeah.
So you require outside faces.
Yes.
Who raise strong voices against, and especially when nobody is there to speak for the disenfranchised, for the marginalized groups.
Yes.
Because many a time, governments don't consider the marginalized group, the smaller groups.
Yeah.
So these are sections of society who raise their voices.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I will request to go in civil society as they are doing now. Of course, violence is abhorrent. It should not be, it should never form a part of our
yes.
democratic process. The right to protest, Mahatma Gandhi has given, shown us the way. Satyagraha, peaceful protest, is a fundamental right guaranteed by our constitution, freedom of speech, 19(1)(a). So that right we have, and that right we must assert whenever we feel that it is wrong. That would be my message to our Goan people and to my fellow Goenkars.
Vedin Bab, time kadlo, itli detail an ulele ani maka dista on these amendments, tumcho view va dareka goykar gharat pavcho hoch amcho uddesh ashillo, vel kadlo amche kade ulele. Thanks a lot, it was pleasure talking to you.
Dev bare karo.